Good evening. Warm welcome to all of you. Today's agenda, OCT Live, step-by-step educational program of OCT guided PCA, that is simple to complex. The intention of this program is to educate how to use OCT during PCA. As you all are aware, intravascular imaging plays a major role in identifying the block, a lesion length, and sizing of the stent. What type of block is there? Is it calcified or lipid or fibrous? And really, if it is severely calcified, the patient requires any block modification. Once you do the block modification, that block modification is adequate or not, any upsizing of burr or device is needed. And subsequently, once you implant the stent, that stent is adequately expanded or opposed very well, and at the same time, have you covered the entire disease segment, any geographical miss, and any edge dissection is there, any medial edge dissection, significant dissections are there, then these dissections have to be covered with additional stenting. Similarly, if under expansion is there, which is the single most important predictor of future stent thrombosis and restenosis. So always, once you implant the stent, optimize this stent result, that is apposition, expansion, and covering the edge dissection. These are all very crucial in completing the PCA procedures. So if you achieve all these goals, definitely the MACE rate will come down. With this brief introduction, today we have two live sessions, but one case will be transmitted from Care Hospital Gachibowli, and the main operator, Dr. B.B. Purohit. Actually, he is very senior and very close friend of mine. He's a very good teacher, and I told him to show all the step-by-step approach to OCT. And similarly, everybody knows very senior cardiologist from Jaipur, Fortis Jaipur, Dr. Sanjeev Rai. Unfortunately, his patient had some fever. Because of that, then he wanted to show the live in box, which is very interesting. And he's also very prominent cardiologist, and he's a very good teacher and very good academician. And he will show how to do the OCT, right coronary long lesion, step-by-step approach. The purpose of this symposium is to educate about the usefulness of the imaging before, during, and after. And it will be very, very useful program. And I hope this will be useful to all of you in your day-to-day program. And this will be kept in even YouTube also. After that also, if you want, you can access these live cases. And today's the first case, Dr. B.B. First case will be operated by Dr. B.B. Purohit and expert panel members, Dr. Selvamani, Girish Naswadi, Dr. Shashikant, and moderator, Dr. Narsarazu. And next session is live in box by Dr. Sanjeev Rai, and Dr. K.M.K. Reddy is the expert panel member, joined by him, Dr. Gopal Krishna, Dr. P.L.N. Kaparthi, and moderator, Dr. Arun Kalyan Sundar. Then Ravi, you can connect it to live case transmission from Gachibowli Care Hospital. Welcome, Dr. Purohit.
Sir, we have Dr. Purohit sir with us.
Yeah, are you able to hear? Purohit, welcome.
Yes, can you hear me, Sridhar sir?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sridhar, for giving me this opportunity. This wonderful symposium. And who all are on the dais?
Can you speak loudly? I think I'm...
Just take this out.
Ravi, welcome. Is it okay?
So we are hearing, but little feeble.
Can you hear me now? Just ask him to adjust volume.
Yeah.
Can you hear me now, sir?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Sridhar sir, for giving this opportunity. And I will be showing a very interesting case. And I thank all the people who are sitting on the dais, Dr. Selvamani, Girish, Shashikant sir, Dr. Naraj sir, and we'll be showing all the steps because this is the first case which will be in this wonderful seminar webinar. So I'll be showing the basics, how we are doing a basic OCT and how do we interpret the different images. And then subsequently, all the complex cases will come, how to do all those complex cases with the help of OCT. So I'll be basically focusing on the basics, how we do it. Now, this gentleman who is there with us is a 48-year-old gentleman who was diabetic, hypertensive. He came to us.
Sorry for interrupting. Slightly increase the volume.
Yeah, this gentleman came to us in 2016 with Antraval MI.
Yeah,
and we did a stenting to LAD at that time with a 3x38 DES on November 2016. He had a normal LV function subsequently. Then we did a CT angio, which was done in October 2017, which showed stent was patent. Now, since last few months, he's having angina, and we took him for an angiography once again. And when we did an angiography yesterday, we found there was a critical lesion in the distal LAD after the stent. Of course, the stent was patent, and because of the different characteristics which were there in the vessel, so we thought that would be an interesting case for showing the basics of image interpretation and how do we decide on the stent in this patient. So before going into the case, I'll just tell you a little bit about the OCT catheter, so that when you have this understanding with the image, you can follow it when we do it live. Now, this catheter basically is a very small catheter, and with the distal tip is only 2.5 or 2.7 French, and it can go through a 6 French or 7 French. That is mainly we use 6 and 7 for removing the contrast from the vessel, so that there is no artifact when you are doing the OCT. Now, this catheter has three markers: the distal tip, and then before the distal tip, almost 27 millimeter before it, you have the lens marker. So when you are taking an image, your lens marker actually should be crossing the interest. And then you have a proximal marker, which is almost 54 millimeter before that. So this 54 millimeter is the high resolution. So you take a very high resolution imaging, which is really helpful when you do a post OCT run. And then you, in the initial run, we take a very fast frame with a very quick time. That is called a survey mode 75 millimeter. And then in the proximal part of the catheter, you have a hub through which you flush, you clear the contrast, the whole system. So that I will be telling you when I do the case. And then next slide. So you have different morphologies based on what kind of lesion you have. Next. So next line. So based on the lesion characteristic, when you think of doing a OCT, the two important things which we have to look at is pre-PCI strategy, and then how do we optimize the stenting, which is called post-PCI strategy. So these two have been given a very interesting name, MLD Max. MLD is basically for the pre-PCI, that is assessing the morphology, length, and diameter. And then post-PCI, again, you have a Max, that is medial dissection, apposition, and proper stent expansion. So if you follow this simple algorithm, you will be able to give a good result to your patient. So before PCI, you must look at the morphology, how the lesion looks, then look at the length, and then the diameter, what is the size of the vessel, so that you can choose appropriate size of stent. And then post PCI, always check whether there is any dissection which is going into the medial, and whether the stent has apposed properly, that means there is no malapposition, and whether the stent has expanded. Now, there were two interesting studies done on this, and these studies really told that when you follow this algorithm, the MLD Max really changed the strategy in more than 70 to 80% of time pre-PCI, and post-PCI, they had to change by almost 20 to 30% time. One of the study was done by our own Indians, Dr. Rani Matthew and their team did it. Now, this is how a normal OCT artery looks. And if you look at the image properly, the most medial one is the intima. In the center, you can see there is a round thing that is actually the catheter. At 6 o'clock position of the catheter, you can see there is a small hub-like protrusion, which is actually the wire artifact. So don't get worried about that. So that in the normal UNC, you can see there is a very clear, if you see on the image, which has been expanded on the right side, you have the almost a yellowish thing, which is at the innermost part of the lumen, that is the intima. After that, there is a little brownish, small 1 millimeter rounded thing, that is the media. The inner part of that is called the internal elastic lamina, and the outer part is the external elastic. And then after that, you have another yellowish thing, that is the adventitia. So you have to identify whether you are able to identify this IEL or EL to decide what is the size of the vessel you can take. Next. Now you have different, go to the next. You have different characteristics of the lesion. Now this is a normal fibrous fatty plaque. If you see at the 3 o'clock position, it looks relatively normal. But at the 12 o'clock and 9 o'clock position, you can see there is a fibrous plaque there. Now next, I'll show you how it looks. Now this is a fibrofatty plaque. If you see from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock position, you have a very yellowish kind of thing. And then subsequently there is something which is hazy, which is going on. You are not able to see properly. And that is because of high attenuation happening in the fibrofatty plaque. This is more of a lipid rich plaque. So there where you have a high attenuation and you cannot see very clearly after that portion. So that is how a lipid rich plaque looks. And this is a calcific plaque. And you can see between 12 o'clock to 3 o'clock, you can see there is almost like a map like thing you can see. And that is actually a dense calcification. And this is a very superficial calcium, which is almost touching the intima. This is because of low attenuation, and you can see a very clear cut demarcated line. And that is how a calcium looks in an OCT. Next. Now this is a thrombus, red thrombus. Red thrombus is again high attenuation. You can see something is protruding inside the lumen at almost between 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock position. And that is actually a red thrombus, which is high attenuation. You cannot see anything going beyond the little bit of brownish thing which you are seeing there. Next. And this is how we classify the different types of calcium. This really helps us in choosing our strategy. On the left side, you can see it's a deep calcium. From 6 o'clock to 11 o'clock, you can see a little bit away from the lumen. You can see there is a clear cut demarcated thing. So because it is away from the lumen, we call it as a deep calcium. So this deep calcium cannot be taken care of by anything. So you have to use either a compliant balloon, or you can use IVL in this kind of setup. Whereas in the middle picture, you can see at the between 11 to 3 o'clock, you can see there is a clear cut demarcated superficial calcium, and that calcium can be taken care of if you use a rota or a orbital atherectomy or something like that. That can be taken care of by this superficial calcium. Now on the right, on the extreme right, you have what we call as a nodular calcium, where you have to use either a rota only, otherwise you will not be able to do anything with for this. Next. Now this is what I had told you, how you decide. This is a Schlosser algorithm, which tells us about the significance of this calcium, whether you have 180 degree arc, or the length of the calcium should be more than 5 millimeter. And if the thickness is more than 0.5 millimeter or less than 0.5, based on that, they give various scoring, and the score is 4 or more. Definitely, this is going to cause trouble. So you need to be very careful in preparing the lesion. Next. So with this brief introduction, I'll go into straight to the my case. So you can see the angios which we have taken. Now, can you show the first run? Just run it. Now you can see this is the angio, and I hope you are able to see the angios, right?
Yeah, we are seeing. Yeah. Go ahead. We are seeing.
This is a PA caudal view which you have taken. You can see the LED, proximal LED. You can see there is a calcium which is seen in the proximal to mid part of the LED. And then subsequently, you see there is a stent. And after the stent, you can see there is a tight lesion. Come to the PA cranial. Next shot. Now, this is a PA cranial view. Here again, we see the same thing. The proximal to mid part, there is a calcific chunk in the proximal to mid part. Subsequently, we have the stent. And
kindly run the angio. No, angio is not running. Please play it.
Running.
Angio is playing. No?
It is running, right?
Yeah, running.
So it is running. I think the internet speed.
Angio is playing.
Right. So.
Okay, but you know, then go ahead.
So you can see the stent, which looks pretty patent. But the distal LED, you can see there is a very tight lesion, almost 90% of 90% stenosis is there. So I'll just cross the lesion with the wire, and then subsequently we'll open up the OCT to see whether the OCT can cross this or not. If it doesn't cross, then maybe we can dilate it a little bit and then take a shot. So anything you can always discuss with us during when I'm doing this procedure. We can go ahead and have some discussion during this time. Give me the wire.
Salomani, you can discuss anything if you want. Salomani, Shashi. Yeah,
Yeah, but only thing is I couldn't see the Angio better, but it's not seen here. It's not running. I think some internet problem here.
Give me the normal.
But anyhow, I could see a stent there in the middle lady. Distal to that, there is a lesion. And now your plan is to cross it and then you want to take the OCT. Do you want to pre-dilate it before taking OCT or what?
Yes, definitely. I will first try to go ahead without dilating if to see whether it crosses or not. But if it doesn't cross, definitely I will use a 2 millimeter or a 1.5 balloon to cross it.
Dr. Shashikant here.
Yes, you can.
Dr. Shashikant here. Just wanted a point of discussion. Dr. Purohit, see, when you cross this very tight lesion with the catheter, the distal runoff of the contrast would be very, very sluggish. The lens would not move proximally and would not get a good image. I suggest we should pre-dilate this lesion before you even give the contrast, because the distal runoff would not be good and you would not get good images. Any discussion at this point, particular point?
Yeah, that's well accepted. And but anyhow, I did not see the distal lesion because of some internet issues here. But
anyhow, the distal lesion is quite critical.
Yeah, if the lesion is very critical, it is always ideal to pre-dilate it so that you get a very good clearance of the runoff.
Yeah.
Otherwise, your OCT images may not be good.
Yeah.
Sir, we have a minor technical glitch, sir. Like, we'll be back within 30 seconds.
Yeah, unable to transmit. The discussion, Sheikh, these type of lesions are mainly edgery stenosis, the stent edgery stenosis. Most oftenly, it's because of the improper landing zone during the previous PCI. Suppose if you are landing a stent edge in a lipid-rich block or thick fibromatous block or calcium block more than 51 degree. Most of the time, these patients are prone for edgery stenosis. That is the reason whenever you implant the stent, always see that you are implanting a landing zone with a less block burden. So lipid-rich block should be avoided, particularly thin cap fibroatheromata. And this fibrous block burden should be less than 50%, and the calcium angle should be less than 71 degrees. And suppose if you are landing in a very unhealthy landing zone, the chance of those that may not be re-stenosed, but proximal or distal patient may develop. And when you go with high pressures also, these plaques may lead to dissections. Sometimes these dissections may not be seen on angiography, but subsequently lead to edge re-stenosis. So that's the reason even the recent intravascular imaging criteria, there should be at least 5 mm on either side of the stent should be healthy zone. Now, what do you say, Selvamani?
Yeah, definitely your point is well accepted. And as you rightly said, you should land in an area where the plaque burden is less than 50%. That is one thing. Yeah. But so many times what happens is we may not get a clear-cut landing, especially in diffuse disease. And there is always an issue. But if that is not there, always try to get a zone where there is no lipid and then block burden is less than 50%, then you will get a good result. And that is a very important point. Then this might be a case of geographical.
The problem happens in a different. Yeah.
It could be a case of geographical miss. Probably sometimes, if you don't use the angio co-registration, we tend to miss the distal lesion or proximal lesion. That is also an important point.
So we have cath lab with us, sir.
Yeah.
So we have now opened up this catheter, which I had shown the picture of it before earlier in the PPT. And you can see the markers here. The blue tip, which you are seeing, is the distal marker. Just below that, there is a distal marker through which the wire will exit. And then you have this, before that, you have the, now you have this syringe here, which is basically to purge the saline contrast and make it full. And you must see whether the contrast is coming down. Now you can see this red thing is the lens actually. So before that is the lens marker. You can see the air is still coming out. So I'm just trying to purge it and clear it with contrast.
You can switch the images so that your hand is bigger.
Yeah. Just to zoom your hand and the catheter image. Ask them to zoom catheter image.
Yeah.
No, on main screen.
Ramesh, can you switch the camera as a bigger screen?
Yes.
Now yeah, that was good.
So you can see this is the lens, which is there. And at the tip, you can see there is a blue color tip that is 4 millimeter. After that, you have around 27 millimeter for the tip. Basically, it is to protect the lens. And then subsequently, you have another marker proximal to it, which is around 54 millimeter. So your run will happen from here to the proximal marker when the run is taken. So once you have purged it with the contrast through this, then we start taking the catheter inside.
You just show the threading of the wire also.
I'll just show. Yeah.
And one more important step is connecting to the dock. So how to connect it to the dock is also important. But I think you have already connected it, but you can just show the dock.
How I'll you just show do you this.
Yeah, you can just...
Can you zoom it here? So this is the distal part of the catheter, which has to be connected to the dock here. There's some technical issue with the machine. So it got stuck. So now you on the dock, you have this. Can you show this? This one. Yeah. Here you can see the hole. In this hole, this has to go and fit in. Automatically, it will just get locked here.
Yeah. Take it inside.
Just can you switch off and switch on? Completely switch off and switch on. Yeah. If you do not connect it properly, again, there will be an issue. You will not be able to get a proper image. And very important is you must handle this lens very carefully. Otherwise, it will get distorted. And if you are not able to cross any lesion or any time, it's better not to push. Prepare the lesion and then try to take it again. Because these are made of optical fiber, which are very fragile.
A question, Dr. Selvamani, a question for you.
Yes, sir.
And to Dr. Sridhar too. See, is there a point of calling catheter fatigue when you do 2 or 3 runs with OCT? The fourth run, it's very difficult to push the catheter in sometimes.
Correct.
Is it because of the superficial layer, which is not very slippery now, or is it because of the catheter fatigue, which sets in after 3 or 4 runs of the OCT? The fourth run, the last run, is very difficult to push the catheter into the vessel. Any discussion on this particular point?
Yeah, you are correct. It is with same with any balloons or any catheter. The more you use, the coating goes off. And then probably that tension or that strength of the catheter also comes down. And definitely there is a difficulty in tracking the OCT catheter. More so when you are reusing catheters because we sometimes reuse catheters also. So, but there is a technique for that what we follow. When on the third or the fourth time, when you are taking the catheter, if you're finding it difficult to push it, what you should do is you pull back your wire and push along with the wire. With the wire, you push the catheter in, then you will be able to track it a little bit more easily. The problem is there is a lot of friction between the wire and the catheter, and the coating is gone. That is why it has become difficult. So what you do is you pull back the wire a little bit and along with the wire you push it, then many times it will be easier to track it.
So now our system is ready. We are trying to connect it again. So we just go in and then... Yeah. So
you'll have to turn it towards yourself.
Clockwise movement, and it just gets connected. It is trying to establish its connection. So you can see again, the moment connection establishes, the lens starts blinking again. Shall we do the eye? So once you have connected, you just test the lens by just holding it between two fingers, the thumb and the index finger, and you can see it will form a beautiful eye in the imaging. Once you get that kind of eye, that means you understand that the imaging is proper. Can you see the eye in the OCT? This is how it looks. And then your catheter is ready to be inserted. Now loading the wire is also very important, because you should be very careful. The wire just exits before the lens. So if you are not careful, you may damage the lens again. You can see I have just made a little bend, and then this wire just comes out from the side. You could see this, right? If you don't make this slight bend, the wire may just go in and cause little damage. So now we are ready to go in. So as I said, I'm not very sure whether this catheter will be able to track the distal lesion or not. If it doesn't, then I'll have to pre-dilate that lesion. So just enough length, you just pull it in, come in. Come inside. So you can see the two markers are coming, the distal tip and the lens marker. And you can see the third marker now. I hope you are able to appreciate all the three markers, right?
Yeah, yes. We are seeing. Go ahead. Show your screen there, cath lab screen.
So am I, is getting stuck there. I'm not very sure if it will go or not. Thoda upar dikhao. No, it will go. Just pull it back.
Such lesions, Dr. Shashikant here, such lesions I found in IVUS to be a better tool than an OCT. I just want to comment from the expert panel what they would suggest.
As you said, my personal feeling is for stent failure, I think the first tool is OCT. The type of images and how it guides your treatment, I don't think IVUS will help you in so much thing. And similarly, IVUS also has a lot of difficulty tracking sometimes. It depends from case to case. But here, as you rightly said, if we had pre-dilated that lesion, probably the catheter would have tracked still better. And anytime in stent failure, if possible, I think OCT is more better than IVUS. That is my personal choice. And even theoretically also, there are a lot of advantages of OCT compared to IVUS in stent failures.
See, in stent failure, we can clearly decide whether it is because of any thrombus is there or not, whether any dissection is there or not, and whether any calcium is there or not. All those things can be much better delineated with the help of OCT.
And as you said, regarding the issue of tracking the catheter, we have had either way. So there are cases in which OCT catheter had difficulty in tracking. Right. Similarly, we had cases where IVUS catheter had difficulty in tracking, OCT catheter went very easily. So it all depends on the case, angle, and the wire, how we are using it. Yeah. And difficult tracking might be there with any catheter.
Basically, it's the washout of the contrast really which is important here. So that's what makes it more difficult. If you have a poor contrast washout distally, the images should be suboptimal. That's my worry.
You're correct, definitely.
Yeah, that is right.
Multiple times when I had a diffuse distal
lesion, dilate and acquire one more image. Yeah, that is better to dilate and take an image. And regarding the tracking of the catheter, one is never put a force on the OCT catheter. It's just attempt also, it can lead to damage of the light source. Particularly in tortuous or 90 degrees angle vessel, or the calcified wells in such cases. The one thing, always don't use the old catheter when you are using the radial. Take an guiding catheter. The second one is, as Salomani told, the pullback, just pull the guideline guide wire and along with a guide wire, like a buddy wire, you can advance.
One point, Sridhar, Dr. Shashikant here.
And really, that was...
Give me that.
Distally, we also use guideliner to place the OCT catheter, because once you put the guideliner, it's very easy to track for you. No need to put a lot of pressure. Yeah. Then you can track well.
There'll be some
the damage to OCT. Another one, fourth attempt. Like any other catheter, fatigue will be there because repeatedly when you are pushing, then it may kink and that may lead to loss of force while tracking the catheter. That is also an important point. So that the reason, never apply force. More you apply force, the number of uses will come down. And really some difficulties there, pull alignment is proper or not, catheter. Then pull the guide wire, fold the guide wire and catheter together and advance. Then you take the guide catheter, otherwise that is also not working. Take the guideliner and place distally.
See the one point of discussion.
Yeah.
When Purohit is working, I think one point, you see, even if you don't push the catheter, after fourth passage into the vessel, there's a lot of resistance in the catheter movement in the fifth, when the fifth time you pass the OCT catheter. So sixth time when you do an OCT run, you have a lot of resistance there in the vessel there. And even in the, sometimes it has difficulty even getting out, exiting the guiding catheter itself.
Yeah, that is because of the PVC coating. Yeah. It will be swollen and catheter profile is lost. Definitely more uses you are doing.
So I found a situation wherein
then it will become
initially I should take an OCT catheter. Yeah, just one point of discussion. The very diffuse distal LAD disease, I picked up OCT as an imaging modality, saying I would be able to give a better sizing of the vessel, a better anatomical description of the calcium, better assessment of the vessel architecture. So I chose an OCT over an IVUS. Now, what happened? It's just a point of discussion, not that I'm favoring IVUS, but it's just a point of discussion that when the OCT lens reached the distal vessel, and you start injecting the contrast, the lens doesn't move at all. The lens, because the distal runoff is not there, and a 90,000 rupees OCT catheter is just wasted because you have a poor distal runoff.
Yeah, guide is in.
Two distal lens are difficult.
So very diffuse distal disease. When you think your runoff is going to be difficult, probably I would defer picking up an OCT, though I would get a better images if only the contrast has a good distal runoff. This is a very important point which I found in my practical use. The catheters were wasted. My image quality was very poor.
Yeah, you are right. That is
so I'm taking the run now.
Ultimately,
Dr. Sridhar, I'm taking the run now.
Runoff should be good because the blood clearance should be there.
Doesn't matter. I can take one more run. Shall we take one more run?
Can you move slowly? Can you move slowly? Show the
distal part.
Entire fragmental to distal OCT, step by step.
वो जरूरत नहीं है हमको नहीं नहीं
go slowly,
slowly from here yeah.
Move the cursor slowly yeah from there you can yeah you can analyze
what is you can see here and the
operative just move cursor slowly
you can see this looks like a vessel
yeah
was little bit of yeah. black on the 3 o'clock to see now you can see little calcium coming up between around 6 o'clock and this calcium you can see is going from 6 to 7 o'clock you can see it small little bit of calcium there and then when we are coming proximally little more proximally there's a little bit of there's a, this looks more like a nodule like You can see there at the, around 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock. You can see a little bit of nodular thing there, and then when we come still proximally, no, there's not dissection.
So did you dilate at this spot?
Yeah, this is the place where we are dilated.
That's because of the balloon dilatation. There is some thrombus and dissection there.
Yes. You can see this is a dissected area.
Yeah, it's a dissected area because
the dissection at around 3 o'clock position clearly. And some little bit of the lumen. This is again, a dissected area. You can see around 3 o'clock. Now it's come proximally. Now you can see a little more fibrous, and around 4-5 o'clock, you can see a little bit of calcium there. You can see around 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock calcium, and then you have a lipid plaque between 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock. Another calcific chunk you can see, and. You can see that calcium, but these are not more than 50% of arc come proximal. Now this is more of a fibrous plaque, fibrofatty plaque. You can see come proximally. You can see now you have the stent there, which looks pretty well opposed. You can see this white dot means the stents are pretty well opposed there.
What is the area there, Prohit?
Can you just see
stent area? I think
3.54 is a stent area coming there. So we had a 338 stent there actually.
Okay. It may be more if you yeah.
More. Is around coming 3.9. So
just keep moving.
You can see there is no significant instant restenosis here.
Yeah.
The stents are pretty well opposed and they are pretty well covered also.
Yeah.
You can see each strut, there is a little bit of endothelial lining covering the stents. You can't see any uncovered stent there. All the stents, struts, you can see they are covered by, they are covered. Come proximally. You can see, just hold on there. You can see the, if you see, just next frame. Yeah, you can see here, all the white dots, you can see they are the stents. And you can see on the top of the stents, starting from 12 to 6 o'clock, you can see all the white dots, which are the stent struts. And then on top of that, there is a layer of intima over that, suggesting that there is a clear cut coverage of the stent struts. Yeah. And
for 1 second, you can remove the
less,
stent.
Here rendering. Is less, no? 2.47. Distally, it's
where it is slightly less.
So you take out that stent rendering, you just remove?
There is under expansion, almost 82%.
Now it will be see, that white many times you will have a lot of confusion. Now it is very clear.
Now you can see here very clear.
Yeah, once you remove the rendering, you see the struts are well inside the endothelium.
Yes.
And there is some growth all around. But there are very few small areas probably where the covering is less. So when do you say it is?
Where exactly the stent struts are and how they look. Yeah, this is the one stent. Then there is another stent strut. You can see all this very clearly. You can see, but there doesn't look to be very significant restenosis here.
Endothelialized.
Yeah.
So when do you say it is adequate endothelialization? When you say it is hyperplasia or inadequate coverage?
See, up to 200 micron, if you are having the distance, then I don't think there is that is the adequate. If little bit of strut is there, you have three or four different types of uncovered stent. One is totally uncovered. Then you can have a partially uncovered stent there, where a small amount of strut will be there, just hanging at the lumen area, and part of it you can see it is going inside. And then these are the struts which are completely covered. You can see them.
Okay, how old is this stent now? It is 4 years old.
Almost 5 years old.
5 years. See, many times what happens, no, in OCT, when you go for stent rendering, if it is 4 years, 5 years, this rendering does not work at all. It will be probably embedded there. You cannot see. But here, somehow we are getting good rendering. The entire stent is well seen. You may not get the similar finding in all cases.
Yeah.
Because it picks up when it is fully covered, it may not pick up very well.
So these are all nicely covered endothelialized stent struts. You can't see a single. You can see here this come proximally. Just wanted to see something more. Anything else in the proximal part? So looks pretty well covered stent here. So there's nothing much to be done in
No restraints inside the stent.
Yeah. It's around 3.7, 3.8, 4 continuously. When we come more proximally, you can see that. You can see a little bit of poor contrast clearing in the proximal part. That's why you are seeing this little bit of swirling movement inside. But
so was it in a hand injection or power injection?
Yeah, it was a hand injection.
Probably there was some fatigue, because when it's a very long stent,
yeah,
you'll have to inject for a longer time. Probably by the time it reached proximally, the force has come down. That's okay. And see, here your lesion is predominantly distal to the stent.
Yes.
And the stent edge looks okay on OCT. When do you say it is stent edge problem? Is the lesion at least 5 millimeter around the stent edges? And how far is it? It's somewhere around 7 to 10 millimeters from the stent edge.
It is exactly after the stented area. So we can say that it's an in-segment restenosis. You can say that. Maybe when we were doing an angio, maybe there was some small amount of lesion was there and the stent was on top of that. Because it's almost 5 years down the line. So you can't say that it happened, or it may be a new lesion which must have progressed. A small amount of lesion must be there which has progressed over a period of time. If it had happened within 1 year or 1.5 years, maybe it would have been more specific, suggesting that it was definitely a mismatch or missed lesion, you can say that. So what size of stent shall we take? Come to the initial part.
Come to the lesion now.
Now let us see.
Yeah. So yeah, now how will you select the landing zone?
Yeah. Come. Yeah.
I think you have to cover that. Yeah. Otherwise, here I think reasonably
good. This is the dissected slightly area where we had done a. So I'll take this out.
You go to distal.
I'll take this out.
I think you have to take it 5 o'clock. Go to five. Go to that is 10. Still, you have to move. Still, that side, opposite side.
No, go, you have to go away. Distally.
Away.
Yeah. Go further.
Away.
Yeah.
I think.
This should be the ideal area from where we have to take this.
But distally, some more lead is there. You can take it as a landing.
So what is the lesion length?
No, again, this is there.
Okay, it's almost at the distal end of the vessel. Some disease is there.
Hold here. Yeah. You can see you some amount of here, media there.
You can land here.
Look at the linear image which is there at the bottom. Yeah, that is the area where we have the... No, you can't take that one. Come proximal. you don't see any international elastic lamina here, so that much we cannot say. No, come inside, take it from the lumen. Yeah, okay, bring it inside. So it is somewhere current around 2.2.
I think take 2.5.
Yeah.
Take around 15.
Or we can take 2.2 and upsize it with another balloon. Yeah, this is 1.7.
You can see now. I think the same 2.0.
I think what I will do is I'll try to take a 2.25 and then based on the result, I will upsize it with a 2.5. Because I'm not sure about the IEL here. So I'll go by the luminal diameter and then upsize it based on how it looks. Length, just see what should be the length from there to the stent area, or go a little more. Yeah, that's here. From here to the just after the stent, you can see there is the point where it is 20. You can just see there. Come back. Or thoda aage jao. Yeah, how much it looks after that. Yeah. Or thoda go a little more. So this is around 14 or 15 millimeter.
And take precise sizing, otherwise you may land. Yeah.
This one. Just go beyond. Yeah, 15.
Yeah, 15
so
would be fine.
15 here, it is more. So it is 3 millimeter. So I will take a 15 only, 2.25 into 15.
Yeah.
If you go up to extreme end, how does it look? Just see where that, ekdam distal, where that another lesion is there.
No, this is a very diffuse disease.
Yeah.
Distally,
looks very tight. Just see, you landing zone. That disease on the entire.
This is the just run this. Before this,
As a point of discussion, Dr. Sridhar.
Yeah.
Dr. Saramani, for you too. I mean, since there's not much of a calcium here. Is there a role of a drug-eluting balloon here instead of putting a stent? It's just a theoretical discussion. It's quite distal, very distal bed. And
because the heart block, definitely drug-eluting balloon will lead to more dissections.
Yeah.
And reasonably good size, that in between. I think you can land that means 5 millimeter from the distal and 2.5 or 5.5. Recheck. If needed distal, you try to do with the. But this segment needs covering with a yes, because a heart block, if you do with the high pressure, definitely dissections will be there. The thrombosis formation will be more.
There are already some significant dissections.
And there you can.
And but as he said, there is always a point, very distal disease. Drug-eluting balloon also has a role. And we have done either. Sometimes I have done only drug-eluting balloon and left it. But here, I think we have a stent 2.25. And I think it's better to stent there rather than just doing one balloon there.
Because we have already done a balloon. And you can see there is a significant amount of thrombus forming and big dissection there. So, a drug-eluting balloon may not be a good option here.
Like a lipid or that much you can, but here is some areas of calcium, though it's not very significant, but thick fibrotic block is there.
Dale.
Ravi, are you there?
1240.
Yes, sir, I am here.
Can we go on to the next case? Definitely. Then we can come back to Purohit again. Is it okay?
Yeah. In the meantime, I just do a post OCT run and see how it looks, and then we'll come back again.
One important point in this usually is when you post dilate, especially don't dilate off the native stent, that is the previous stent. Place it exactly in your new stent. Otherwise, probably you'll unnecessarily be damaging that already endothelized stent there.
Yeah.
That point is very important. Just remember where you kept the new stent and then keep your post NC balloon.
Ravi?
Come. Yes, sir. Dr. Sanjeev, sir, can you start, please?
Yeah.
Dr. Sanjeev, sir, you need to unmute.
OCT? Chalo.
Yeah. You inform him. You inform Prohit will come back. Just you can inform him. At the end of the session, he can show the remaining case.
Yeah, yes.
Dr. Sanjeev, sir, can you hear us? Dr. Sanjeev, right? Unmute.
Sir, we can't hear you. Dr. Sanjeev, sir, we can't hear you.
Unmute.
We'll take it 20 cc. Then I'll give inject from here. Hold the wire. Come forward.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah. Come forward. We are able to hear.
Dr. Yeah, am I audible?
Sanjeev Rai, welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Sridhar Kasturi. And it's been a real honor to get me involved in this live transmission today. But unfortunately, my patient is not doing well. So I had to defer that case because this was an OCT-based case scenario, and he with a fever and a rising creatinine, I can't do an OCT in him. So right now, what I decided is to go for a live in-box-like session. And this is a case which I did on 23rd March, about 10 days back. And with me is my associate, Dr. Anurodh. I think I'll hand him over to present the history scenario.
Good evening, my
respected Sanjeev Rai, we have a Dr. Gopal Krishna, Dr. PLN Kaparthi, and Dr. Selvamani, and Dr. Shashikanti. They are with us. You can interact with them during the transmission.
May I start, sir?
Kaparthi, you can unmute.
Yes, I can hear. Okay, Kasesh.
Yeah. Dr. Gopal Krishna.
So with permission of a respected panelist and moderator.
Over to you, Sanjeev. You can introduce.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. Myself is Dr. Anurodh. I am associate consultant in unit of Dr. Roy, sir, in Interventional Cardiology Department in Fortis Escorts Hospital, Jaipur. So with the permission of a respected dais, I am going to start with clinical profile. This was 69-year-old gentleman with the history of a classical stable angina since 4 months. And it was in NYHA class 2. That was on working on the usual activity. And the symptom increased in duration and frequency since 2 months. He was having comorbidity of diabetes mellitus and hypertension since more than 5 years. Or in a cardiovascular examination, he was hemodynamically stable and there was no abnormal finding on cardiovascular examination. ECG was showing a horizontal ST depression and T-wave inversion in V2 to V6. And echo was showing normal LV size with inferior wall and posterior basal wall was showing mild hypokinesia with overall LVF of 45%. Yeah. There was no mitral regurgitation, no aortic regurgitation, no aortic velocity was 1.2. Cornea angiography was done on 90th March and it was showing RCA CTO in mid-segment and the distal vessel was filling from a contralateral injection. And the left anterior descending artery was showing proximal calcified ulcerated lesion and mid-intermediate lesion. So final diagnosis was made of hypertension, diabetes mellitus, coronary artery disease with stable angina since 4 months, with unstable angina with two vessel disease and mild LV dysfunction, and patient was having normal sinusitis. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. And am I audible?
Yeah.
So can you switch over to the angiography, please? So this patient had undergone an angiography elsewhere. So I would start with my basic views. And as Dr. Anurodh described him, he's a diabetic and hypertensive patient, 69-year-old gentleman. And he had a CTO in the RCA. So if
Dr. Sanjeev sir, we can't hear you.
I think his internet is unstable.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Now we can only hear.
Yeah. This inner view is visible?
Yeah.
So this is a dual injection shot. And if you can look here in this, there is a CTO of the RCA. And if I just hold it at the distal, the distal RCA is completely filling. And if you look at here, there's a small micro channel. It's a tapered cap, proximal cap, a small micro channel. And then thereafter, it's a long disease segment. And actually, the distal RCA has also appeared diseased till the origin of a small PDA, and PLV is significant enough. So the basic idea was to cross this CTO, and since the tip was very tapered one, it did not look like a very difficult one. So I used a microcatheter, and this is a pilot wire, pilot 200. And all I needed is to redirect the tip appropriately, and my wire slipped through the micro channel into the distal RCA, as you can look here. So that's how it crossed. And having crossed this, I advanced the microcatheter. And over the microcatheter, I exchange it for my workhorse Schion wire here. And having done that, just dilated the CTO portion. And after dilating the CTO, this is the anti-grade injection. And what we see here, it's a long segment disease, diffuse disease. And there was some narrowing in the PL, which was not there in the contralateral shot. Maybe it's a spasm or maybe. So at this point of time, normally I do most of my CTOs with an IVUS imaging, but looking to the diffuse disease, a long segment disease, and to look at the plaque morphology. Also in the LAD, there was another ulcerated calcified lesion. So the imaging modality that I chose here was a OCT. So this is how the OCT run would look like. I would request Dr. Anurodh to present the OCT findings. And this is the pullback from the OCT. Over to you, Anurodh.
Sir, this is the OCT pullback of a right coronary artery from distal to proximal RCA. There are four panels. Upper left panel is angiochorization, and right upper panel is cross-sectional view. And in upper lower panel is a luminogram, and lowermost panel is a L mode of longitudinal view. So starting from the distal point. So we have taken reference point at reference sizing at in distal RCA at this level, and it is showing from EM to EM 3.16 in one line and 3.27 in another line. So average downsizing was done to 3.0 mm for stenting in distal RCA. Further pullback. It is showing a dissection flap starting at about 25 mm. And it is also running proximally. So there is also irregular intraluminal mass, which is showing high backscattered. So it is suggestive of the white thrombus from the 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock position. So this is a proximal RCA, and little bit part is healthy. Furthermore, pullback is showing the disease RCA in proximal most part. And we can see luminal area is 5.38 mm square at this level. There is also a fibrous plaque at this level. So this is the OCT pullback of RCA after pedialysis. Over to you, sir.
So that's the lesion here. We have a long segment lesion of more than 38 millimeter, right from the entry point of the CTO to the distal, slightly more than 38. The distal reference segment was 3.15 and 3.25. So I thought 3 mm stent would be enough. The challenge was the proximal disease part, although there was a landing zone out there, but proximal to that was again somewhat more disease. So issue is, should I stent the only the CTO part or should I extend right up to the proximal? So any comments on that?
Yeah, welcome Arun, you can add some points. Arun, are you there?
Dr. Arun sir is on mute, sir. I think he'll...
Arun, unmute. Dr. Arun. Yeah. Shashkant, you can add some points. Selvamani.
So, if the plaque burden in the proximal segment is more than 50%, probably I would say we would suggest, I would suggest probably we can cover that particular segment. Or if you want to go with the physiological way of managing this situation, probably I would stent the CTO segment with a long stent, do an FFR for the RCA and see if that proximal RCA lesion is significant or not. These are the two options I have. If the plaque burden is more than 50%, probably I would stent that particular segment. Second option is to do a physiological assessment after putting the stent in the mid segment and take a decision whether I would need one more proximal stent. Probably 38 millimeter stent would do the job in this particular segment. But if you think the proximal lesion is significant and it needs to be covered, probably a 48 millimeter stent should be all right. Now, in the last 2 weeks, I have done some RC, right coronary artery stenosis vessels. The vessel appeared to be 2 millimeter or 2.25 millimeters. When I did an imaging, the distal vessel appeared on the angiogram to be 2 or 2.25 millimeters. And on the imaging, I found that the distal vessel size is about 3, 3.25, 3.5. So imaging makes a dramatic change in the sizing of the stent. Now, it's not glorifying imaging, but it's that the practical realities of it is that three vessels, both the three RCAs, what looked like 2.2.25 millimeter vessel, I would have ended up putting a 2.5 millimeter stent and then did a post dilatation with the 2.5 and would have been happy with the angiographic result. But when I did the imaging, the vessel size was actually 4 millimeters. So it changes your outlook so much. Especially for the RCA, last three right coronary arteries have been really an eye-opener for me to size your stenting. Those are my comments. Any more?
Dr. Arun?
Hey guys, sorry.
Dr. Arun is there. Welcome, Arun.
Yeah, so, sorry. I had, you know, got delayed in the lab and then had some technical issues just logging on. I just got in. I think I caught a little bit of Dr. Sanjeev Roy's talk, and the question really was about Dr. Sanjeev, could you just elaborate the question one more time, if that's okay?
Yeah, sure. I'll just start it. Sure. I would love your comments, Simon. You are one of my proctors for the CTO. So this was a dual injection. You can look at here. Sure. It's a CTO in the RCA. There's a dual injection.
Right.
Angiographically, looks like the PL is the major branch here, PDA very
right,
small.
Right.
And it's a long disease. There's a tapered proximal cap here. Some appears to have a micro channel out here. So that's a disease here. So what I did is I selected straight away a Pilot 200, and all I needed is a little bit directing the tip towards the micro channel, and it smoothly sailed through, slipped through the micro channel. Some here and there, small branches, all it redirected to the main branch and it easily slipped through. And that's the anti-grade cross, no wire escalation needed. And I advanced the microcatheter. And after advancing the microcatheter, I just took a short, contralateral shot to be very sure that I'm in the main vessel. Advanced the microcatheter, changed with my workhorse Xion wire, and then dilated the CTO segment. And just after dilating the CTO segment, this was a small 2x15 balloon. And that's how it looks like. Did an OCT, and you could see the OCT images there out there. And in the OCT images, there's a long lesion. There appeared to be some spasm in the PL, which I think the nitro took care of. And this is a long lesion. Now, the challenge is, if we look at here, the distal reference the is about 3, EM to EM is 3.1 and 3.25. And the proximal here, it is 3.5. This could be covered with 38 millimeter stent. There is some moderate disease out here in the proximal part. So as we were discussing out here, so to cover the entire part, do a physiology guided, or look at the plaque burden and do it. So that's what the stage that we are in.
So, I mean, I don't know what others, you know, what they said was, I mean, ideally you want to, I mean, it does look like there's a fairly long segment of disease, but you have a nice landing zone before even the PDA. So, I mean, that, so I'm just seeing a snapshot, but it looks like perhaps, you know, you could cover the whole thing with two long stents, like maybe a 3-0 distal and a 3-5 even proximal, and then post edit accordingly based using OCT.
So I think I moved.
Kapati, are you there?
Yeah, yeah. Hello.
You can add some points.
Doctor Sanjay.
Yeah.
Definitely, the OCT plays a significant role regarding the decision making of the disease and length of the stent, as with a MLD max. 100% in this given case. You can just cover the CTO segment with three, and you optimize by means of a 3.5 stent, or you can directly take 3.5 and just nominally you can deploy distal and proximal, because the distally it can accommodate up to 3.5. Then high pressure with 3.5, and you can leave that proximal mild disease, disease proximally. There no need for physiological testing. It is looking like, actually, even doesn't look like also borderline. It is just a minimal disease you can observe. And as Dr. Shashi already described, especially the CTO distal targets have a restrictive remodeling. But once you open it, I think intravascular imaging is mandated, looking like, because your decisions are totally will be different before and after. Before it looked like a diffuse disease, if you do this intravascular OCT and there's a media thickness is well preserved, then automatically it will grow in size. And there are the lessons learned from intravascular imaging. Thank you.
Shall I move?
You can go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah, so, you can go ahead.
Here I move ahead with this is a 38 millimeter stent. This is 3x38. And I felt the 3x38, I was covering the lesion part, but it was landing up into a plaque. And so I thought I'll use another two stents, as Dr. Arun was also suggesting. So this was just after 2 millimeter dilatation. I further did not dilate because it was looking like a soft plaque. So went ahead, dilated this. And because I landed up in the disease segment, so I used another long stent covering up right up to the ostium of the RCA. And to my surprise, the ostium was actually very broad, as Shashikant was also discussing. It was actually a 4 millimeter at the ostia. So distally, it was 3 millimeter. Ostia was nearly about 4 millimeter. And we optimized here with a balloon of distally at 3x15 non-compliant, at the mid part 3x15 non-compliant. and the ostia, including a flaring up, was done with a 4 into 12 at a pressure of 20. And that's what the ostial flaring is being done. And this is the angiographic view with an OCT pullback. And let's have a look at the OCT pullback. Anurodh, can you present that?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So it was a long pullback. So we divided into two runs because that would give us a complete picture. So this is distal to the proximal, and then we have an osteoproximal separately.
So this is the pullback of a right coronary artery after stenting to see the optimized stenting result. And it is from distal to proximal RC basically. And it is showing well opposed and well expanded stent.
Edge, distal edge.
In cross-sectional view, we can see there is no edge dissection distally. And this is the stent part starting distally. And in wall length, it is well expanded and well opposed stent without any tissue prolapse or other complications.
So if we can see in the luminogram, there is an icon of a red colored triangle, which shows it is less than 80%. And yellow one is between 80 and 90. And above 90 is the, white colored. So you can see a rough glance into the luminogram. It's all white. So the stent expansion is more than 90% in most of from the distal to the proximal RCA. See, the next run was the osteoproximal.
So this is the OCT pullback from proximal to ostial RCA to see the optimum result of the stenting. Okay. So it is showing well expanded stent in distal part of the proximal RCA. And now coming on more pullback. The minimal stent area at this level was more than 7 mm². And just distal to the ostium, the expansion area is between 70 to 80%, but there was a well opposed stent and there was no complication. And the luminal area was about 11 mm². So it was good luminal area despite the this expansion percentage.
So again, if you look at the automated measurements in the luminogram, here it is white, so it is well expanded. Here it is yellow, means 80 to 90. A small segment of red color, which was here the 72 was the least expanded. And otherwise it is most of the time it is 78 and 80%. And again, it is white. So I accepted this result because it was an area, minimal stent area of more than 11. So quite acceptable. The proximal at the ostia is 14. So its ostia was totally covered. And you can see here the ostia is just covered here. So that's how it looked like. And you can see here the angiographic images as well. So any comments before I move to the LAD?
No, this was great. Great yeah, result. Nice result. Looks wonderful. Looks yeah. wonderful. And I mean, I would just say the one point is that many times we just underappreciate the distal vessel vasculature until like the proximal stuff is taken care of. So again, I mean, people might have looked at this initially and said, oh yeah, it looks like a small vessel. But I mean, now you can see that it covers a fairly large territory. Very nicely done.
Yeah, I think I made the point very important that the distal vessel appears to be, yeah, Dr. Sheshikath here. The distal vessel quite often appears to be very small, 2.25 mm. The PDA appears to 2.25. When you do an imaging, the PDA would be probably 3 mm in size. So it you definitely have to upgrade your stent to a bigger size quite often. And we are really grossly underestimating the size of the distal vessel if you don't have an imaging. And that's my point which I wanted to make.
Yeah, Kaparthi, you can. Then you can move to LAD.
Yeah.
Okay, it's a very good result actually. And I think that may be appropriate. Sometimes in CTOs, long stents, overlap stents is appropriate for a good acute and as well as long-term results.
So let me move to the LAD. This is the LAD, the caudal view here, and the circumflex looks quite okay. There is a tight lesion in the proximal LAD, and this is how it looks like. It's almost like a trifurcation. The OM is very early origin. The angle between the circumflex and the LAD is less than 70, and the disease is starting right at the ostial LAD. And if you look at the cranial view, this looks like to be an ulcerated lesion. I'm not sure whether you can appreciate there appears to be some calcification here, not a great degree in angiography, but moderate calcium. There is another intermediately appearing lesion in the mid-LAD. So my initial plan was to just deal with this proximal LAD with a short stent, and maybe it's a crossover stenting because the angle was too narrow to safely place it at the ostia. So that's what my strategy was. And with that intention, I just wired the LAD. And because it was a significant lesion, I thought the contrast may not go through. So I just balloon dilated with a 2 millimeter and 15, and then did the OCT. And here during the OCT, I actually diluted my contrast a little bit so that my, this is a diabetic patient. So it's always a CTO up there. And I thought I might reduce the contrast load by diluting it. And I think Anurodh will present the OCT images of the proximal LAD. Let's look at, and there is some interesting in store. We will discuss further.
So this is a OCT pullback from mid LAD to left main. And the purpose to do OCT was to define the plaque morphology and for reference sizing, obviously for left main. And furthermore, OCT was also done for distal LAD to see the intermediate lesion. So this is the OCT pullback, and in the lowermost panel is showing L-mode of longitudinal view pullback. And we have done reference sizing at this bookmark. In a cross-sectional view, we can see the reference sizing from EM to EM. It was at 3.0 mm. So coming further pullback towards left main, there was wide thrombus. We can, as we can see in this cross-sectional view, sorry. Irregular high backscatter mass in the lumen, which is suggestive of the white thrombus. On further pullback, it is showing calcium extending from the 6 o'clock to near 11 o'clock. And it is deep calcium. So this is the healthy the bifurcation site of the left main. It is showing healthy LCX ostium, which is disease free totally. And the calcium is also extending about 270 arc at this level, 22 mm. And it is deep calcium.
So at this point, my strategy was to modify the plaque here in the proximal LAD. And then go ahead and stent it. But at this point of time, I also thought, let me interrogate with the imaging the distal mid-distal lesion. So let's go to that, and you can see here my pullback, which appeared angiographically as an intermediate lesion. And since my catheter was already down, so I just pushed it and took another image, and that's what the mid-distal LAD looks like. Let's have a look.
So this is a OCT pullback from distal to mid LAD, purposely done enough to define the intermediate lesion at this level in coangiocoregion. So healthy part, this part was completely healthy, as we can see the intima media and adventitia, free of plaque. On further pullback, we can see the fibrofatty plaque was starting from the 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock position. In the distal LAD, that was intermediate in the angiography. And we have defined this bookmark for reference site for the stenting in the distal LAD. At the two level of radially in this circumferential view, it is showing 2.76 and 2.85 mm EM to EM. On further pullback, it is showing fibrous plaque.
And this is the part where the millimen lumen area was 1.74 mm square. So surprisingly, in angiography, it was looking like an intermediate lesion. But in luminogram and cross-sectional view, we can see this area was about 1.74 mm square. So this was the start of the deep calcium from the mid LED, and it was extending in the proximal LED. Over to you, sir.
So let's have a discussion, your inputs on what should be the image guided strategy in this case. Dr. Arun, Dr. Sridhar, can you hear me? Dr. Shashikant?
Dr. Shashikant here. Can I make a comment?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So quite often we see that what appears to be the angiographically tight lesion, the actual critical lesion may be a little distal away from that. So angiography is now will not be able to assess the right way site of the most critical point. That an area of 1.74 is probably will correlate with an FFR of less than 0.80. If you correlate with the FFR, so probably this lesion also is equally significant. To me, probably this lesion would be I would stent this area, this particular segment, and then take the proximal stent of a different size. I had one observation was there's quite a lot of discrepancy in the size of the left main versus the proximal LED. Can you tell me what is the size of the left main and what is the size of the LED, Dr. Sanjeev Roy?
It was lumen to lumen, like 4.8 or something, 5.
And the LED?
LED was 3.2, like that.
So there's a lot of discrepancy in size. I don't know if there's any stent which you can blow up to the size of 5. I don't know. I have had done some recent cases wherein I've blown up the stent by 1.5 millimeters. At 3.5 going to 5, and I had a lot of the stretch architecture, the stent architecture getting disarrayed, and three patients had come back with a restenosis in that particular area, the left main. Though the angiographic result was very good, the imaging result was very good, but because of the stent disarray, because of a very large balloon being used for dilating these vessels, I had a stent disarray and I had a restenosis in these patients. So I want to comment from the house and the expert panelists. What do they think with this? The discrepancy in size is really, really too much here. It's personal opinion, but I would take some learning points from the expert panels.
Yeah, actually, this proximal LED is around 3.5 and the left main is around 5. Yeah. Am I correct? Can I make a comment here?
Proximal LED is 3.2, like, you know, 3.2, 3.2.
Yeah, you get.
Probably, see, we have certain stents here, especially Zion's expedition, 3.5 stent. You can expand it to 5.5 according to bench testing. And we have been using this policy for quite some time now, more than 2 years or 2.5 years. And I have not seen any problem with that type of issues. But only thing is, if you exceed beyond 5.5, then probably you can have a stent fracture and then whatever things you were explaining can occur. And what is the other's opinion? Kalyan, Kutsundaram, Arun, and Sridhar, sir, what do you do?
If you see the recent publication from the EBC guidelines, and the one JAG publication, if you see all the latest stents like Onyx or Synergy or Expedition, all these stents 3.5, you can go safely up to 5.3, 5.4 without any problem. And 4 stent can go up to 5.6, 5.75. Only taxes is the stent, the 3.5 can be expanded up to 6 as per the publication. But usually 5.3 to 5.4, any stent can be stretched without any problem. But these are proven in bench tests, but in spite of the publications, whatever possible, always if you are having so much discrepancy like a 3.5, 5.5, you take 4 just with a nominal diameter, and go with 5.5. Otherwise, take 3.5, up to 5, you can stretch it without any problem. That is not a big issue, but only one problem is you will not have any 5.5 balloon in the self. Most of the time, the coronary balloons, you will have only 5. You can't have more than only few balloons, you are having a 5 mm. So that time, we have taken some peripheral renal balloons like 5.56 to stretch. But usually, majority of the time, 4 to 4.5 is the left main size. But rarely they will have a 5.56 like that, which is very unusual situation. But the regular stents, you can upsize up to 4.5. This is my opinion. Usually stretch up to 5 mm. You usually taking the 5 mm balloon. I didn't find any problem. Even though they say more you stretch, the polymer coating may be lost and stent integrity may be lost. But this is the
Dr. Sridhar, sir, we can't hear you properly.
Oh, okay, I thought it was my connection. Okay, good.
So, Arun, you can just put your comments. Do you expand your sense to that level?
You kind of have to, right?
And, I mean, that chart we have to keep in our shelf mainly.
I think Dr. Sridhar, there's a lot of lag in your talk. Do you want to turn off the video, perhaps? Dr. Sridhar?
I think sir has got a poor connection.
Yeah, all right.
Connection. Looks like it is connected. You can go ahead with the discussion. Also, the final result as well.
Okay, just in the interest of time, I'll try to be brief here. I mean, first of all, really challenging case, Dr. Sanjeev Roy. I mean, you always deal with this issue. I think imaging is critical. That's point number one. Point number two really helps you identify good landing zones. I mean, I think that's kind of the whole idea of doing this workshop was to kind of illustrate the rationale behind MLD Max, really. So, I mean, I think it definitely helps you, you know, identify length, you know, where your landing zones, et cetera, are going to be, et cetera. Now, the challenge of the size mismatch, I mean, I think it's always there, especially when you're stenting across. I do concur many of the stents. I mean, I think it's important for us to know when we deploy these stents about, is a 3.5 and a 4.0 stent, are they the same stents actually that are just crimped on a different balloon? I mean, many times that's what they do. They don't come up with, they're not different stents in each. So, depending on the family, like 3.5 and a 4, many times are the same stent on different balloons. They just expand differently. So that's something that we ought to know. It is also important to know in terms of how high you can go without damaging the integrity of the polymer, et cetera. I think that is very, very critical. You cannot be reckless about it. You can't just take a 2.0 stent and say, I'm going to blow it up to 3.5 because I can. I think that's an important point to know. And I think as Dr. Sridhar and Dr. Soleimani have already kind of talked about many of the current generation stents are capable of going up to, I mean, I think 5.75 is different companies. I'm not going to get into the specifics of which company goes up to how much, but it is important as we deploy these stents, we know what we are going to do, how high we can go, etc. And the other point also is that make sure you do have short balloons on the shelf, because when you do end up doing pot, etc., you definitely don't want to, I mean, you let us say you have not gone all the way to the ostium, right, in the left main. You want to stay within the stent, and also you don't want to get into the LAD. So that's important that you have, 6.0, 8.0 balloons, et cetera, at the higher sizes.
And coming to the point there for the distal lesion, we are sure that the lumen is somewhere on 1.75. Although we have an evidence saying that probably if the lumen in OCT is less than 1.95, it's going to be FFR positive. But there are very few trials to document that. And it's very important if it is associated with something like thin cap fibroathroma or ruptured clot there, And if the lumen is less than 2.5 or somewhere around the lumen what you have, I think we have an evidence from one or two trials like Forza trial where you can stent. But without all those findings, only with lumen, we have limited data. And to be really scientific as of today, if we don't want to do physiology, like if you really don't want to do RFR or FFR, probably based on OCT lumen of around 1.75, which is definitely less than 1.9, we can stent it. But to be more scientific, if RFR is there, I think you can always do it, document that it is ischemic, and then go ahead and stent it. Because you are going to stent it across a big diagonal also there. So I think all this point you should consider and take a decision.
Yes, I agree with Dr. Salomani. Definitely, just the OCT luminal should correlate functional evaluation. Then only we'll get a complete result. Depending on morphological, we should not do that. Thank you.
An MLA of 1.7 is really tight. I mean, I agree with, fully agree with the physiological concept. But there are studies which have clearly shown that an MLA of 1.7 would correlate with a positive FFR quite often, especially with such a large LED territory being distal there. If it is a small branch or something like that, I would have deferred the decision. But with such a large distal territory, a 1.7 is a really tight stenosis. And there are definitely studies which have shown that FFR would be positive with the 1.7 square millimeters of area, MLA. Comment from the house?
Yeah, your point is accepted. See, if for some reason, if you cannot do functional testing, in such cases, we can apply this rule of lumen size and decide on stenting. There is no doubt at all. For example, if it's an ACS, and then if there is a slow flow or some issue where you cannot do an FFR.
Look at the territory. Look at the territory distally. Look at the territory distally. It's really large territory what you have.
I do understand, but is there anything doing anything wrong in doing an RFR or FFR there? I don't think there is.
No, definitely. There's nothing wrong in it. Only it's just the cost going up there. And yes.
One study we have.
Scientifically, yes, you should do an FFR or an RFR.
So, but sorry to interrupt. Cath lab is ready with the final result.
Yeah, just so you can correct to. Purohit, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can go ahead.
Yeah. Just show me the previous shot. Yeah, just run it. Just run the angio, no? Just after this. Next. Yeah, run this angio. So can you see the angio, sir?
Yeah, we can see.
Yes, we can see.
So this is where we have deployed the stent. Next. So after stenting, when we took the shot, looked pretty okay. So we took a post-stent OCT again. And Abhinav, show the OCT. Yeah, can you see this? So this was the post-stent OCT. Just run it. You can see it looks okay. But now, just hold on. You can see there is a dissection there. Can you see around 3 o'clock position, there is a dissectant which is going into the media. And if you see in the lower part, it is just distal to the edge of the stent. The longitudinal, you can see there. Can you see this dissection, which is there from 3 o'clock to almost 5, 6 o'clock? Yeah, so this is just after the stent, it was there. So in the angiography, we thought that probably it's just an overexpanded stent. But in the OCT, we found that it is clearly a dissection, which is there. And it is going into the media. So the algorithm which they have about MLD max, where you do a max for the post-stenting, and the medial dissection you see, and apposition and expansion. So the first itself, medial dissection, we can see clearly. So we had to fix this. So continue this. So then what we did is there was one more issue which happened. Go to the next. You can see the wire which is there, next previous. Yeah, you can see the distal end of the wire, that black tip, it got caught in one of the branch. And when I was trying to pull, it was as if the wire was lengthening. So what I did is I took a 1.25 balloon and pushed it down and then disengaged the wire and then I pulled it out. You can see at the distal end, it was almost going to cut off there. So finally, I removed the wire and then took another wire. Go to the next. So I took the wire next. So So put one more wire there and position it in the vessel next. And then I took one more stent there based on the OCT finding, and then another 2.25 stent I deployed, 15 millimeter. And you can see the final OCT run next. And then we post-dilated it with again. And then this is the final OCT run which we had. So, because now you can see the distal vessel looks pretty good and the stent looks pretty well opposed. There is no more dissection in the distal end. You can just see the vessel looks pretty clean, and this is the stent which is coming up and looks pretty well expanded stent. Luminal area is almost more than 2.5, which was a 2.25 stent. We post dilated it. So it looks pretty good, a well expanded stent. And then you can see here it is 2.7, 2.9. As it goes into the first stent, it reaches 3, 3.5. So looks pretty good expansion. Apposition looks pretty good. There is no under expanded stent or malapposed stent. And I think that is where we stopped it and we took final angio run. Now you can see the final angio run here. This is again the PA caudal views. Looks pretty well expanded stent in the angio also. PA cranial, next shot. And in the PA cranial also looks pretty good result. So this is where we stopped. So this is how our OCT helped us identify the length of the stent as well as the distal dissection which was there. And if it was not for that, maybe we would have just given some NTG, diltiazem, and then left it. So that's all. Any comment from the expert panel or?
Yeah, excellent demonstration. I think we should appreciate you for doing OCT even such a, in a distal vessel. Many times it's very difficult to do a OCT in a very distal vessel, tracking the catheter there. And you could identify a clear, significant dissection. Many times, these are the dissections which gives rise to probably stent thrombosis and probably, again, restenosis. And good that you were able to put one stent there and cover it off without further dissection. And then you have done a OCT post that, even after that stent, it's an excellent thing. We should definitely appreciate for you to doing this, and you have clearly demonstrated the use of OCT there in identifying the complication. But many of us would have done, what would have done is distally taking the OCT might be difficult. So after stenting, you wouldn't have done a OCT at all. But if possible, I think it is always better to do imaging after especially such a long stent. And it's very important for better long-term outcomes.
If you look at the PA caudal view, we can see clearly a long distance where we can always park the lens beyond the stent which where we had deployed it. So that's the reason why you can see here, there's a quite a long length of vessel there where we could park the lens marker beyond. That's why I went ahead with the final OCT run. And we were able to get it distal to it and demonstrate that there was no dissection or any other complication there. So that's why it was done like that.
Yeah, this is a nice demonstration of.
There's a great thing, Dr. Puroit.
Yeah, Girish, you can.
Sorry, I had difficulty logging in. Yeah. I mean, it's nice to see him operate. I worked with him, fantastic. But, you know, OCT is also a great teacher in the sense that oftentimes we can do little. Should we have really done another stent? Could we have tried a DES? I mean, I'm DEB rather than DES. What do you think?
If you look at the vessel size, it looks almost like a 2.25, 2.5 vessel. And sure. I had done a nominal diameter because if you see in the first attempt, the OCT did not cross. So I took a 2 millimeter balloon and just went nominal 10 atmosphere. And you could see big dissection and the thrombus forming there. So if I had taken a DEB also, maybe the same thing would have happened. And and if you know how we deploy DEB, you first have to pre-dilate the DEB and then finally you need to take a DEB and take it to the nominal and keep it for almost 30 seconds or 1 minute. So just a 2 millimeter of a normal balloon, a semi-compliant balloon could cause such a dissection. I don't think in the hindsight, if I look at right now, I think it was a good decision to go ahead with a stent rather than a balloon only. Maybe I would not have done it after seeing that big dissection with undersized balloon. So a standard size balloon of 2.25 maybe would have caused more trouble than helping us.
Yeah, I think most of us extended it. I mean, it was kind of bad on the angiogram itself. I mean, it's, yes, we don't like full metal jackets, but I think this is one of those areas where you probably, I think most of us would have probably stented it. But I think it's good to have the discussion anyways.
What is the take on, you know, one last question. What is the take on taking 2.25 or 30 millimeter stents? Do they really last long, and should that be the practice just because we see something in the OCT?
It's a debatable thing, but there are a lot of data which is already there that if earlier with a 2.25 stent, we were not able to get a good result. But now with this newer stent and inner struts, I don't think that should be an issue, because earlier stents were a little bulky and thicker stent. So in a 2.25 millimeter balloon, if you take a thicker strut, that is going to cause more trouble. But this thinner stent which are there with 60 micron, 70 micron, that should not be a problem if you take, even if it's a 2.25 millimeter balloon. That's what I feel. Yeah.
So now the reason for my question of that is, you know, we would be seeing so many things with the OCT. So if it's a 3.5 millimeter vessel, you see a large dissection, should we treat the same as a 2.25 vessel with a dissection or a 2 mm? So should it be the same?
As per the MLD max, what they say is if the dissection is going to the media, maybe that is the dissection which you should be treating. If it's just a superficial dissection only in the intima, maybe you can still get away with it. But if it is extending into the media, maybe that is where you need to intervene.
I mean, irrespective of the vessel size, should be what practice?
Because if you put a stent and there's a stent thrombosis, then the whole vessel gets compromised because there's no distal.
Proximally. Thank you.
Now, actually, if you see the Onyx small vessel data, Arcero small vessel data, there is so much data. Even stenting of the small vessel, the mace rate is drastically reduced because of the newer generation of stent, the thinner struts and everything. And even metal jacks, kids with the newer stents are also doing extremely well with a low mace rate. The earlier generation stents, a lot of metal jackets, the stent thrombus was more, but the recent long stenting also, the mace rate is much lower. And here the plaque burden is very high and medial dissection, and he has taken a very right decision and with a nice illustration of medial dissection with a lot of plaque. And if you see the where there was a dissection, there is a calcium plaque is also there. That is a point where the hot point and soft point, where you stretch it will. So that's the reason when you are seeing the landing zone, the calcium angle should be avoided. And the thick, here plaque burden also more than 50%. And that has to be. Now at the end, if you see, distally looking like a trilaminar vessel. Previously it was not there. So that is also a very important point. Definitely this procedure is going to help the patient by putting additional stent. I think he has done the right thing. And when you are using the image, use the image to the full extent before, during, and after. Then you will, that will become the cost effective. Sometimes what they do, they simply angiographically is looking fine. Then they don't do the ang. Many times you can't see under expansion, you can't see the malapposition. And sometimes my edge detection may be missed. They may think it's like a plaque burden, plaque collapse like that. But I think when you use it to the full extent and then prove that seeing is believing. That is very important. But congratulations, Purohit. Really, you have done a very nice case and you showed beautifully step-by-step catheter preparation and every step you have showed very clearly. Thank you. And anything, if you want to say something before you conclude that one from your side, Purohit, then we will move to Sanjeev Rai. Then we'll have a discussion and then you can join for discussion.
Yeah, before concluding.
Vinod is there. I think Vinod, I could see the Vinod.
Yeah. Where is Vinod? Vinod? So I would like to thank my whole team who helped me do all this procedure. Dr. Vinod was here. I think he got a call from emergency. So I just think he just went out. And I have Dr. Sujit, who is also working with me since last one and a half year. And the technician, which we have, Mr. Charan, and our brother Madhu, and the main sister, Vijaya. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good to see you, Dr. Purohit. Great case, as always.
Thanks, Dr. Arun. Thanks a lot.
Let us go to Sanjeev Rai. Ravi, you can connect to Sanjeev Rai.
Yeah, we are switching, sir.
Yeah. Meanwhile, all of you can have a discussion.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yeah. Hi, Dr. Sanjeev. Yeah, you're back on.
So we were discussing on the, you know, about the criticality of the distal lesions going by the imaging criteria with an MLA of 1.7. Most often it correlates with 1.9, but as Dr. Silvamani pointed out, there are no hard end comparison of the studies with an FFR. Definitely at this point of RFR or FFR would have been useful, but actually there was in this case some cost constraints. And secondly, this was a long diffuse lesion. So most often what we find, if the lesion is discrete or tubular, it may or may not be, but usually in the, but that's not a rule, you know. Usually it turns out to be positive, but here adding an extra cost of 40,000-45,000, I thought that I'll go by the imaging criteria in also dealing with it. I would invite any, you know, opinion of divergence if we have.
Dr. Girish, can you want to comment anything? Mainly you can discuss on the usefulness of OCT for functional evaluation. Is there any role? Because Shashi told something, I will also comment. For that, you comment, sir.
No, I think it's a great tool, to be honest. Especially, you know, in our Southeast Asians, the disease is never focal. So the pre-procedure OCT really gives you too many insights. One, the length of the lesion. The second, the plaque characteristics. Is it purely fibrotic, purely, you know, atherosclerosis, or the calcium? And if calcium, whether superficial, deep, circumferential, what is it? And then landing zones, both proximal and distal. I think understanding that helps you to precisely choose your strategy, minimize use of additional hardwares, whether, you know, you want a cutting balloon or just one single direct stent if there's a purely atheromatic plaque without much fibrosis. We may think OCT is expensive, but if correctly used when it is necessary, it saves a lot on your preparation, usage of hardware, and great outcomes. That's my take on OCTP procedure.
Actually, there are dozen studies regarding the OCT for functional assessment, but why they said that this should not be a reliable tool to say this is functional, only in leptomine, IVSR OCT. But here, if you see the range, some investigator told it's about 2.5 square mm, some investigator told 2.2, some investigator 1.75. But usually, if you see all the studies, if less than 2, definitely it will be positive. But if you 2.5, you are doubtful, 2.25, because some investigator told 2.5 square mm below, it is a positive. But if you see the range, the lowest point, usually 1.5, 1.752, usually it will be positive. Though we should not, but as Shashi said, if it is very significant, less than 1 and 2 square mm below, all the studies, some studies showed they took the cutoff point as a 2.5, some study 2.75, 2.2, multiple ranges were there. But every study, ultimately, if you see below 2, definitely it will be positive. But functional evaluation, but when diffuse lesion is there, sometimes it's difficult for us to use the FFR, multiple disputes, all those things, side branches, all the, and in such case, but this should not be used as a tool, but indirectly you can come to a judgment. That is my take home opinion. But when you are seeing the IVUS leptomine, definitely ESC guidelines, SA guidelines recommended 4.5 below. South Asians and Americans more than 6, below 6 it's recommended. But when you take the OCT compared to IVUS, it's about 10 to 15% smaller. Consider like you can take it as a 4 square mm for South Asians and Indian population, where American it will be like a 5.4, because 10%, 10 to 15% less when you are taking the OCT criteria. But as is pointed out, definitely below 2, it would be positive.
See, there one point, Sridhar, Dr. Sridhar, it's a nice comment you have made.
Yeah.
This, if this vessel was a small branch or a small vessel, I would say 1.74. I would accept 2 also and say probably FFR would be positive. Look at the size of the distal vessel.
Yeah, it's definitely. Almost, definitely.
Yeah, the area it is subsetting is quite large, and 1.74 is definitely a tight lesion. I know. Scientifically, right. Yes, physiological guided, but anatomical guided also can be should be a decent strategy.
Yeah, sometimes you can take that guidance. But as Selvamani told, some of the marpelecture, like a Forja study, they have taken like a macrophage is visible, like a thin cap fibroathromatosis, there more lipid content is there, like cholesterol crystals. They have taken that criteria also to, because indirectly you are landing in here. Then you can go to the, anybody, Kaparthi is there? I think Dr. Sanjeev Rai, you can go ahead.
Okay. So what we can see here was proximally at one point, when we did a core registration, it was 270 arc here calcium. Otherwise, mostly it was 180. So here I used a Wolverine 3.5 into, I think this was 3:10. And I used the Wolverine and then followed by a non-compliant balloon here further down. And at the osteoproximal LED, this was 3.5:10. This was 3.5:10 Wolverine. And Wolverine, you know, it's built on a non-compliant balloon. So fairly good dilatation also done. There was no indentation here. So I thought I did modify the plaque here substantially. This is the picture after the plaque modification. Normally I take a shot here for an OCT, but here I avoided an OCT just to cut down the contrast load because it was a long session. And furthermore, the balloon had yielded, there was no indentation. So here the strategy of mine was to put the proximal stent first for the reason that I would have a more leeway as far as deciding the length of the distal stent and to match it more with the distal. So with that intention, and as we were discussing the expansion capacity of the stent here, I have taken a 3.5 × 48 mm Zeiss expedition. And this was deployed at a very low pressure here. I did not want much of vascular injury here because the landing zone, the dimension was nearly about 3. So I used a 3.5 at a low pressure, and then I did a port. You can see here, and the port was with a 5 mm balloon. I went up to 20 atmosphere here with exactly coming up to here. And after the port, this is the view it looks like. And sorry, this is after the port. So you can look at here that not much of overexpansion distally. And here it gave me a freedom to choose the length of the stent and the dimension to land at the relatively healthier segment. And this is at 2.75 × 38 mm. And having done that, I now optimize. And this is a post-dilatation with 3:15 and 3.5:15 balloon, non-compliant. And this is the final OCT run. Let's have a OCT over to you, Anurudh. Distal wall of Ellicott.
Thank you, sir. So this is a OCT pullback to see the stent optimization after stenting in a distal LED stent. So in a cross-sectional view, in a right upper panel, we can see there is no intimal or medial dissection. And it is a well-apposed stent at, we can see the white line above this L mode, which is showing the apposition, as we can see in the right upper panel, showing the 200 micrometer apposition marker of white.
Ahead.
So it is well apposed stent. And we are going from distal to proximally, the minimal stent area is 3.95 at 32 mm level in L mode. There is no tissue prolapse. So in luminogram, we can see the white line, upper and lower white line, which is showing that this is well expanded lung stent, because it is the white line is showing the expansion more than 90%, which is optimal expansion. So now we are in a proximal stent that was 3.5 mm. And it is also well expanded.
So that's the proximal that's the proximal LAD and the left pin, the next shot.
So this is OCT pullback. So we are right now in proximal stent, and we are going from mid LAD to the left main. And his cross-sectional view, we can see there is no tissue prolapse and no edge dissection or intimal, whether it is intimal or medial. And in L mode, there is upper white line, which is showing that it is well exposed, well opposed stent. And in luminogram, we can see two white line covering the stent, which is showing it is a well expanded stent.
Can go to the left main. We'll go to the left main here, and that's the bifurcation at the left main. So we can go into the bifurcation mode here. Let's see the circumflex ostea. And you can see here the circumflex ostea, which is quite uncovered, except for one connector and half of the strut. Most of it is absolutely not covered by the stent struts. So I don't think I would go for a kissing balloon dilatation here. So. And the if you look at the left main here, let's go to the left main. Again, it is well opposed, well expanded, an area of nearly about 16. This was with a 5 balloon at 20 atmosphere. And it's well matching the reference diameter right up to the right up to the ostea. Any comments from you?
Dr. Girish?
What do you think about that, unexpanded vessel segment in the LAD. Do you think should we have done another OCT before implanting the stent in the LAD and then gotten more aggressive at it?
Which area are you in particular?
About from the left, probably osteoproximal LAD, proximal LAD, which is, in this L mode, you can see a narrowing like a dog balloon segment.
Area is good only, but I think it compared with the left main, that is showing
this. So here, if you can look at the proximal and distal to that was 6, and here it is 5.6.
Yeah.
So the expansion is 95%.
95%.
Okay, you're happy with it.
OCT compared with the, it took the reference diameter, the left main,
that left main
showing like a 79%, but that is not true. Actually, it's well expanded strength.
So that's actually not in the that's an osteoproximal segment.
Osteally expanded.
Yeah. Right. And the second comment I had to make was on the circumflex ostium, if you had a significant size, would you not just place a balloon in the ostium of the vessel and just dilate and come back, not a kissing?
I usually do it if we have connectors over that or the strut covering or jailing the side branch. If it is free of connectors and struts, I routinely do not do that. But there will be a divergence of practice. I think I read expert or comments from the experts too.
I don't know, you can comment.
No, first of all, very, very nice case. I mean, I think Dr. Girish brought up some good points. I would kind of tend to do what I think Dr. Sanjeev did here. I think there's also very good application of using the whole, your 3D rendition and the bifurcation mode, et cetera, because, if the strengths are already pretty open, the struts are pretty open there isn't anything there. Do we just have to wire it and balloon it for no reason? I don't know. I personally wouldn't. Given what I see on OCT, I would have probably left it just like what Dr. Sanjeev Roy did. Now, it's different if there is, let us say, something that we see, one or two struts there, and I think it would benefit or it would kind of open up. You've got to see something on OCT or angiogram. Otherwise, why would you just want to do it and you're just, ballooning an area and then risking a lot of other stuff unnecessarily? So I think this is a beautiful illustration of how OCT is helpful. in making these decisions. Again, are there any studies? I don't know if I can quote anything to say if what we're doing is right. It intuitively seems like that. I would love to know what the others think about this.
See, it is always in a point of discussion when you do a crossover, whether you should finally kiss it or do pot, this is always a matter of discussion today. But I have certain criteria, like rightly Sanjeev has done. When I do a OCT, if there are no struts across the side branch, like if it's a very minimal struts there and no connectors, there is no need for dilating it. That is what I feel. But if there is an excessive two or three connectors and a lot of struts around, generally what I do is, whenever I do a final OCT in such a case, before doing a OCT, anyhow, I'll try to put a wire so that I may not do one more OCT after recrossing it. So if it is a distal cross and if there are no, there are a lot of struts and connectors, then I do final kissing. If it is not a distal cross and if the connectors are very less, generally I don't do final kissing there. It is always advisable by before doing your final OCT, you can put a wire there so that in case if there are struts and in case if there is, if it's a distal cross, you can directly go ahead and kiss it and come out. Otherwise, after putting a wire, again, you'll have to do one more OCT. To avoid that, I think you can follow this.
Actually, great points. Dr. Selvamani or Dr. Sridhar, do any of you know of, I mean, I know, you know, we all, this is kind of like where I think the art of medicine takes over, but do any of you guys know of any trials or any OCT data which would kind of support taking such an approach, like when you're dealing with this bifurcation? To my knowledge, there's been none, but I don't know if there's anything out there that I've missed.
Yeah. As of today, there is no literature evidence for this, what we are doing. It is only our thinking and logic. And of course, there are few papers like Roni Matthews and our own experience. I have few cases where we have left the struts and then we have restenosis there. And looking at all these things, what happens if there are plenty of struts and connectors across the side branch? There is endothelialization of the struts and connectors, and you develop restenosis there.
No, I completely agree, Dr. Selvamani, but I'm just saying, studying the utility of OCT in determining strategy. Let us say, the hole is, two struts, and then this is what we do, or no struts, then we leave it be. Compared to a non-OCT arm, to my knowledge, there's been no trial like doing this, because I mean, that would be very interesting to study, even if we get nothing else. I mean, I think we should kind of collate the registry data, because I think that'd be very interesting if we can provide some follow-up.
Actually, there is no big study of bifurcation based on the OCT imaging. Only few reports are there from Japanese studies are there, mainly saying that similar demonstration, like struts are across opening and showing, but long-term data is not available. Only thing is that Illumini 4 and October trial were totally dedicated to October trial is totally dedicated to various types of bifurcation techniques and their outcome. And once that is published, we will come to know about the, they are trying on different subsets like a DK crash and a mini crash, even Gulat, everything. In such cases, we will come to know, but there is no long-term data. But if you take the regular EBC guidelines, routine kissing should not be recommended. It's associated with increased restenosis rate in provisional stenting. It's based on BBC trials and everything. So that's the reason, even if you see the EBC guidelines, never routine kissing is not mandatory in provisional stenting. Only recommended if the side branch pinching is more, a limited flow is there, that time only we have to do it, or FFR is positive. Then only it is recommended. But two stent technique, it's a mandatory. Two stent should not be done without any final kissing and pot. Provisional stenting, only thing is flow is limited. If side branch pinching is there, where you see significant pinching or FFR positive, ongoing pain is there. Otherwise, because we are doing OCT, now we are seeing that struts are across. There is a definitely, if more struts are there across side branch, as Selvamani pointed out, there are some reports because the tissue can grow over that. it can show like a 2 meters, like a 2 orifices, or sometimes it can cause more and more tissue. And the next time when you are crossing, also difficult. So that's the reason you just a small balloon into that one, slightly open, like a mini kissing, like a small balloon, slightly enter into the ostium and do the side part like that. Then you can have a slightly open. Then what happens if you are struts are across, more eddy currents, more platelet aggregation, there is a chance for thrombus. That's the reason these observations they reported, but there is no long-term data to say that this is going to increase the MACE rate.
Your point is very, very accepted, Sridhar sir. Yeah. In any other bifurcation except left main, like paraphragmy, LAD diagonal, some other bifurcation, in single stent strategy, you don't worry about final kissing at all. We can live it. But it's only in the left main where there is a big circumflex. There is even in the EBC, they say that if it's a very big circumflex, I think there is a role of final kissing and then opening the struts. And since we have imaging and OCT, if you document such struts and connectors and you get a distal cross clearly on an OCT, I think you should kiss it. Otherwise, you can just leave it.
Yeah, there. That's what I am also emphasizing. Same. If struts are across, there is a rationale in opening because tissue will not grow and flow current will be better. And otherwise, platelet aggregation, that may lead to stent thrombosis. There is a rationale. If you open, always circular geometry, hassle-free flow definitely is needed to avoid stent thrombosis. So, when you are doing the OCT, if struts are across, better to open it. Yeah, then Shashi, final comments, because we will, I think, sir, is it over? You want to show some?
No, I just wanted to just comment on one thing which Dr. Shashikant had pointed out about the expansion of the stents. Now, if you look at, I mean, this is not absolutely, if you look at here, the connectors and the crown and the struts. So what you see here, the connectors become straightened out and the crown is slightly more flat, but otherwise the architecture remains the same. But as far as Dr. Shashikant's point about the polymer break, yes, it cannot be documented by imaging. I think the current generation, be it the durable polymer or biodegradable polymer stents, they have a good expansion. I think as we were discussing, as Dr. Arun also had pointed out, 3.5 and 4 are in the same platform, except that the balloon delivery system is different and it can be expanded to 5.3 with these.
Yeah. Girish, you can final comments.
Girish,
Chalomani,
everyone. What I learned from some of the gentlemen who started this very early, including Colombo, he keeps talking that any vessel which is more than 2.5, if you can keep the ostium free, you don't have to do a simultaneous kissing balloon, but just do a side pot and then do the main vessel pot and come back. The second one, he says, the minute you commit to a long stent, you condemn the patient for no second option of either surgery or another stent, because the re-stenosis chance are going to be very, very high. The beauty of imaging is we need to learn where to risk and not stent. I think that is where I am looking at OCT to guide me in the future. What can I leave behind without a stent and accept a reasonable lumen? Maybe 20% residual stenosis, but can I just do a DEB and come back? Because the minute we put in small 2.25, 2.5 stents, and then he develops an ISR, then you're gone. We know whatever laser you cut it, you would still not have a quality. So I think imaging needs to teach us further. We need to look at which lesions can be left behind, because we are South Asians, diabetic. I think it's crazy. If you go on stenting, I think we'll not have a second option.
Selvamani, you can comment, then we'll conclude.
Excellent case, Sanjeev sir, as usual. Very good demonstration and then very much utilization of imaging technology. And you selected the exact pot size based on OCT imaging. You sized the left main, and we got an excellent stent expansion. And many times what happens is if you do adequate pot with a big balloon, there are very few stretches across the side branch. That is also an advantage. Only if you don't do adequate path, many times you tend to see a lot of connectors and struts across the side branch. This is also on one point, so which you did extremely well. And I think you should congratulate, we should congratulate you for this excellent demonstration. We too learned a lot of things from here, and it was a great discussion by all the panelists, Sridhar, Arun, Girish, everybody contributed, Sashikant sir, everybody contributed, excellent sir. Very nice discussion.
Shashikant, you want to say something? Shashi and Arun, you can.
I think we should, of course, begin by thanking Dr. Sridhar for having put this together. I think the OCD sessions are always fun. I think, you know, just looking at some of the cases and looking at our own experience, I guess, in the last couple of years, it makes us wonder, how did we do stuff before this, right? I think it has really opened our eyes, no pun intended. So I don't want to add a whole lot. I mean, I think it's important that we do this, not just post-procedure, which I think which a lot of us do. Do try to use it for your, MLD Max is pretty useful. I mean, it's just a catchy acronym, but I think it really illustrates a point. And I think we learned various aspects of it today. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjeev Rai, for showing excellent case and for teaching us many learning points. And thank you, Girish, Dr. Selvamani, Dr. Arun, Dr. Shashi, and for your invaluable contribution. And really, we learned many things today. And I request all of you to join tomorrow morning. We have a 6 complex cases, one left main with high risk, high bleeding risk. And that is by Dr. Belbir, and when Dr. Sharath is showing one DK crash. So I request each and everyone to join tomorrow without fail. And thank you everyone for joining with us for this webinar. Thank you once. Have a great week. Bye, sir. Goodbye.
Thank you, Dr. Sridhar, and my apologies not being able to do live sir, case. But this was very live nice.
This was great. This was great.
Please, thank you very much. And your honored commitment, that's more than enough. Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Thank you. Good night. Thank you. Good night.